Assalamu alaikum and welcome to today's video. So today I'm doing a Muslim lifestyle video, and first things first, let me quickly go through some house rules. So this is indeed a religious video. I will be talking about Islam and Muslim lifestyle, Muslim things and Islamic things. So if you are a person who doesn't like religion or doesn't like talking about religion, if talking about religion offends you, you don't like videos of that nature, then please kindly don't watch the video. I don't know any other way to put it. As usual, I will mention that my channel is a drama-free channel. I don't want any comments of a negative nature. I will have the comments section on moderate, because religious videos attract some kind of weirdos with weird ideas and comments, and I don't want this video to be surrounded by that kind of stuff. So those are just some house rules. Please bear that in mind. I am not trying to convert anyone to Islam. This is a video on Islamic lifestyle, and it is intended to be insightful. It's not a video just for Muslims. If you are not Muslim and you've just stumbled across my video or my channel, you are more than welcome to stay and watch this. It's not about converting people to Islam. It's about sharing a lifestyle and a religion that, you know, I believe is the best way of life, is of course the best religion. I do believe that because I'm Muslim. And I want to share that and just, you know, talk a bit about the stuff that surrounds Muslim lifestyle that's with me today. So I hope I've made that clear, and I hope you all appreciate that. So let's get on with the video. So, of course, Islam is cool. I mean that sincerely. I wish I appreciated it more when I was younger, because there's just so much hidden gems in Islam. And you know, the more you learn about Islam, the more you discover and uncover. And I always say that Islam is like a well of a bottomless well of gems. You just discover this amazing thing, you discover that amazing thing. On a surface level of Islam, it's, I wouldn't say difficult to understand, but obviously there's a lot of misinformation, a lot of disinformation about Islam. And for both Muslims as well as non-Muslims, you know, people misinterpret things, people misunderstand things, and we get this kind of confusion around this religion that is the religion of peace and is, you know, an amazing way to live your life and, you know, all kind of stuff happens. We get ignorant ideas and whatever, you know what I'm talking about. So I'm very glad that, you know, I'm very happy and blessed that I live my life as a Muslimah. And I love my deen, I love my religion, and I believe that it makes me, you know, it brings out the best version of me. And unfortunately, people often look to Muslims for an example of Islam, which obviously it's understandable why they would. But quite often, you know, a lot of Muslims don't follow the exact teachings of Islam. Not just because they don't want to, because they don't know, they're unaware of a lot of stuff. And you know, just because you say that you're Muslim, it doesn't end there. You have to continuously educate yourself and learn things. I was born a Muslim, but there are many things that I didn't know and I still don't know. So I take my Islam as a journey of learning, a journey of uncovering so many wonderful things, knowledge and spirituality and history and culture, all that together. And I must say I enjoy it. If anyone asks me my hobbies, I always say, along with my other hobbies, Islam is definitely a hobby. It's a religion, but it's a lifestyle, and it's a hobby and an interest. It's not a burden at all. And the more you learn about it, the more you love it. So Jummah Kareem, it's Friday today. If you don't know, Friday is our sacred day in Islam. Friday is like a mini Eid. So Eid is one of our Islamic festivals, and we treat Friday as a mini Eid. So it means that, you know, we have a special shower that we do called ghusl, and it's It's a shower that is performed as an act of worship. So we have a special shower that we do. Obviously, you can do this shower anytime, but it's highly, highly, highly recommended that it's done on a Friday, in addition to the other times, okay? But on a Friday, before Friday prayer, we have a prayer that we call Jummah prayer, which is a prayer that we pray in congregation, which is compulsory for all men, but it's not compulsory for women, so it's a voluntary. If as a woman you want to join the Friday prayers, you are free to, but it's not compulsory upon you. But for men, it's compulsory for them. So it's a big day for us, Friday, and I suppose it kind of the equivalent of what was the Christian Sunday. But you know, Sunday now, unfortunately, is not observed much by people. I remember as a kid, which, believe it or not, I wasn't a kid that long ago, but I remember Sundays were quiet days. They literally were. All shops were closed, and on the TV you'd switch it on and you'd see stuff about like Christianity, like hymns and church programs. And now there's none of that, you know. We have very much become a secular society, and you know, God and religion are very much sidelined. And you know, obviously Sunday is just a commercial day, a rest day, a TV day, that kind of thing. Anyway, Friday for us is very much a religious, spiritual day. And we do say Jummah Kareem or Jummah Mubarak, which means Happy Friday. Now, I know some people say that it's bid'ah to say this. I definitely don't agree with this, because at the end of the day, you know, how can wishing someone a happy day, or especially a day as important as Friday, how can that be innovation and how can that be a negative thing? So I am not in agreement with that. I think it's absolutely fine to say to somebody Jummah Kareem. So I'm going to wish you all Jummah Kareem, Jummah Mubarak. Some things to show you. Fridays for me, every day is a Muslim day, not just Friday, which means my life, pretty much the center of my life is Islam, and then everything else in my life fits around it. So quite often in my bag I have some things that I carry on a day-to-day basis to work, shopping, out and about, wherever I'm going. I'm going to show you a few of these things. So this is not a what's in my bag video. So it's not a what's in my bag video. It's just some things that I do carry on a day-to-day basis, just because it facilitates my life to worship on the go. Because, you know, worship is at the center part of our religion. As Muslims, we worship, we pray 5 times a day, and we're encouraged to do a lot of extra stuff. So the 5 prayers that we do are obligatory, but we also do other acts of worship, and we are advised and encouraged to do as much as we can, because those good deeds are what believe that are going to help us in the hereafter, in the afterlife. So as usual, no surprise to you, those of you who are not new to my channel, those of you who have seen like what's in my bag kind of videos and that stuff, you know, a part of my day-to-day life is I usually wear abaya. Abaya is the black flowing dress that doesn't show your shape. I usually wear this dress day-to-day, but just recently it's not something that I wear in London, in about London, for a variety of reasons, which I will explain in a separate video. I don't want to go off in too much of a tangent. But whenever I'm in Qunar, whenever I'm in any Muslim country, I do tend to dress in an abaya and a shayla, which is this is the headscarf. So I have a variety of them, but today this is the one that I have as a prayer one, and I definitely wear all the time when I pray, I wear an abaya, because it gives the full coverage I need. When we pray, we have to cover ourselves modestly, properly, otherwise the prayer is invalid. So I carry this around in my bag all the time. And I like to wear my sparkly ones because I like to dress up when I do pray. I don't want to pray like just in any normal clothes. And this abaya here, it's a jeweled abaya in the sleeves. And the reason why this is special to me is because this is one that my grandmother bought for me. She went to the mini pilgrimage. There are 2 pilgrimages that are part of our religion. One is the Hajj and the other one is Umrah. So it both involves pilgrimage to Saudi Arabia, the holy cities of Mecca and Medina. Hajj is compulsory on all Muslims, and Umrah is the one that's the lesser Hajj. which isn't compulsory, but it's highly, highly, highly advised and highly rewarded. So my grandmother went to Umrah, and she went there and she bought this for me. And this is very special to me. Although the stones do come off, I try to, like, you know, I still love it. And it just reminds me of her, because obviously she doesn't live here. She lives in Kano. And it just reminds me of, you know, a sweet gift from my sweet granny. Yeah, so that's my abaya, which I always carry with me in my bag. The next thing I have is this super, super cute Qur'an. It's a baby one. And yes, I do read Qur'an from my phone and from my other electronic devices, so my iPad. But I do use the iQuran app and another one that I can't remember the name of it. I will link it below if I can find it. I had to delete it off my phone because of memory space. But the main one I have is the iQuran. And I upgraded. I was using the free version for years, but I upgraded to the paid version, which is only like £3. And it was definitely worth it because you get to listen to a variety of different recitals from different sheikhs. I know the free one is fine, but you can listen to one recitation, one reciter. When you download the audio MP3s, but I upgraded and I can listen to, I think, 6 or 7 different reciters, which is really good for learning the Quran, for learning tajweed, actual pronunciation. So I highly recommend you to upgrade if you haven't. It's only £3 and, you know, you can pay much more for other apps. So it's definitely worth upgrading and supporting the developers who are our brothers who've done an amazing job trying to bring us closer to our deen. But on a day, you know, I do definitely love being able to read Quran and recite and stuff electronically, but I think it's important to connect back with the book. And the reason why I like this Quran in particular is because even though it doesn't have the transliteration, you can see it's all it's all the Arabic and then the English translation. This thing I like about it is that it does have a nice interpretation with a story quite a lot. So you can see here, we've got the Quran surah, and then we have all this here, which is telling us the story of the messengers coming to the earth. The messengers being sent. It just goes into detail, giving you the background of the revelation of the exact chapter and stories about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all prophets actually, and articles of faith and really good knowledge. So it's worth having a good read. So you can see behind me here, this is where we keep all our Qurans. We have more upstairs, but we keep these ones here. And this Quran here is a very special one. All of them are special, but obviously this one is special because this was a gift that was given to every single pilgrim who went to Hajj. And I did my Hajj, I think, in 2011. On the way home, so when we were at the airport, I think it's King Abdulaziz Airport in Jeddah, we were on our way out of Saudi, and this was a gift from the Saudi government. They gave every single pilgrim a free Quran, and you can see obviously this is entirely, you know, high quality. It's very well, you know, finished. It's just amazing. And they were given Qurans in Arabic with a translation of all languages, so all world languages, Urdu, Farsi, all languages, including Hausa. Hausa is my mother tongue, if you don't know. Hausa is a West African language. And they were given a translation of the Quran, so with the Arabic and the Hausa translation. And I really, really wanted one. And unfortunately, they ran out of the Hausa translation when it got to us. So I was like, oh, I really want one. But because I've got loads of English ones, all the ones that we have are the Arabic and the English, and I would have loved to have one with Hausa, especially the fact that, you know, it's a high quality. It was a gift, you know, because I went to Hajj from Nigeria. I didn't go through London. I went from Kano with my family, so it would have been nice. But anyway, still, it's very special to me. It says here, I think it's got, yes, endowment for Allah's sake from the custodian of the two holy mosques, King Abdullah ibn Abdul Aziz al Saud. He's no longer the king of Saudi. He died, didn't he? I think he died. He's no longer the king of Saudi, but when he was the king of Saudi, he was the custodian of the two holy mosques. Two holy mosques, which are Masjid al-Haram, which is in Mecca, and Masjid al-Nabawi, which is the Prophet's mosque, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mosque in Medina. So yeah, that's a really lovely gift, and I'm really pleased. I think the Saudi government do a lot for Muslims. Like when we go to Hajj, they do stretch their necks out. I mean, human beings by their nature are very ungrateful and very moany and always have to complain about stuff. And yes, it's unfortunate that there are accidents that happen. You can imagine, like, we're talking about a great number of people being together in one place, you know, over a short period of time. So we're talking about, you know, I think it's about 10 million people travel to do the Hajj pilgrimage. And people come from all corners of the world, all different countries, nationalities, cultures, languages. It's chaotic. And I think that the Saudi government do an amazing, amazing job to make it, you know, because it's not easy for them. And, you know, to be fair, people don't make it easy the way, you know, people behave, and it can be really chaotic. But subhanAllah, it's an honour, I suppose, for them to be in that position. And they do really help, because the amount of freebies you get when you go to Hajj is amazing. You get given free food, that's done, fi sabilillah, they do it, they call it, they give you literally so many free stuff, free dates, free zamzam water, free food, real nice food, not just any crappy dish. You get really nice chicken and rice and all these stuff that, you know, it's a blessing. And I think that when someone or when some people do something amazing, I think that they deserve praise. So yeah, you know, it's an experience. If you have been to Hajj, you will know what I'm talking about. And if you haven't, when you go there, I hope you have an amazing time as much as I did. Something that, you know, stays with me and will stay with me forever. The next thing I have to show you is this. This is a very special garment. So it's a scarf. It's not just any scarf. This is called a kufiya. And it belongs to my grandfather, so not my dad's dad, my mum's dad, who is my Fulani, the Fulani grandfather of mine. I will stick a picture of him. And yeah, basically, this was his. And if you recognise this, this is the scarf that originates from Arabia, but it's pretty much most Muslim men have this. And I think the black one, the Palestinian one, I think this is this red one is traditionally the Gulf one. It's either Saudi in origin or Jordanian, don't quote me, I'm not entirely sure, but I know the black one is the Palestinian one, which is also known as the Arafat scarf. And that was quite trendy a few years back, everyone who was anyone was wearing it, regardless of whether they were Muslim or Arab, which obviously is fine, you know, I'm not saying that you can't wear it if you're not Muslim or Arab, please don't get me, please don't misquote me here. But it was a fashion piece that everyone had, the black and white one. But I'm quite pleased that this is an original piece. It's very old. I don't know how old it is, but I suspect it's it's definitely older than me. Like I said, it belonged to my grandfather, and obviously my grandfather is no longer with us. He passed away quite a while back, and it's special to me because not only was my grandfather, a very special noble man, a noble old man, I am his only grandchild. So my mum is his only daughter, and I'm his only grandchild. So it's nice for me to know that I have something that is special and that I can actually pass on to when I have children, inshallah. When I have children, if I have a son, I can pass it to him. And even if I don't have a son, I'm sure I can pass it to my daughter. And I feel that this is a generational garment. It's something that, you know, there's so many versions of this, the cheap version, the fake version, the whatever version. But I know that my granddad, being the man that he was, this would have been a very special, high quality, and it's just special to me because it was something that was his. And Muslim men in Kano tend to wear this a lot when they're religious, so like imams and religious people, or just normal, regular Muslim guys wear this a lot during the Hamatan season, which is like the Saharan winter, when it gets really cold and dusty. And they usually, they have it differently to the way the Saudis and the Emiratis and the Qataris and the Gulf Arabs have it. You know, where they have it with the, like, the black, the gutra thing, the thing that's like, you know, the typical, stereotypical oil sheikh looking guy. They don't put the black thing on there. This is just literally worn as a scarf. Usually you'll see a lot of men just put it over their shoulders, or sometimes they tie it on their head as a turban. But yeah, I just like, it's a special thing to me, and you know, makes me happy when I, you know, have it, because it reminds me of my grandfather. The next important thing in Muslim lifestyle and Islamic culture are dates. So dates, obviously, you know, they were the food of Arabia, and they still are, and they were the food of our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's highly, highly, highly advisable for us to break our fast with dates and water. And I usually can eat dates, like, you know, I used to not like them when I was a kid, but then when I was in Kano, because I used to feel that they look a bit like cockroaches, astaghfirullah. I don't think that anymore, but that was when I was younger. And there's one Lebanese guy in Kano who told me, I was in his shop, and he's a really nice, I don't know, with Lebanese people, they're very generous and very kind. And this guy, every time I used to go into his shop, he'd literally give me like so many free stuff. I'd be embarrassed to go in there, because I'd be like, you know, why are you giving me all this free stuff? Like, you're supposed to run a business. But anyway, going off on a tangent, this Lebanese guy told me that it's haram to actually hate dates, because even if, you know, they drop on the floor and someone steps on it, you know, the fact that, you know, it was something that was beloved to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, we should, you know, love what our Prophet loved, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So since he said that, bismillah, I love them. And my favourite dates are the Medina ones, the black juicy ones, the Al-Ajwa. But these are just equally, or almost equally nice. So whenever anyone asks me what I want from Saudi, when my friends are coming, or my family have visited, I always say bring me dates. And you can see I go through these, a box like these, in like literally 2 weeks, because I do the voluntary fasting Mondays and Thursdays, so I always break my fast. And also I just eat them in place of a meal. If I have like 3 dates and water, it makes me feel quite full up. So there we are. Always makes me thirsty. Alhamdulillah. Okay, so before I leave you, I just want to say, I want to tell you a few of the gems in Islam. So this is the little knowledge I have, and I'm really, I'm not saying that you don't know this, you probably do know, and if you don't know, then please take this as an opportunity to gain something. Now, there are, like I said, there's so many gems in our deen, like there's so many like treasures. You just have to discover Islam and understand it, and you will love it, really, honestly. So the first thing is the virtues of Ayatul Kursi. So Ayatul Kursi is a verse from chapter Al-Baqarah, and it's number 255. I will link it below. And Ayatul Kursi Obviously, like, I'm not going to go into everything about it in this video because I wouldn't be able to, I don't have time. I will link a video that is amazing about it, the real virtues, and I highly, highly, highly advise that you watch that video. It's by Nouman Ali Khan and it's just amazing. If you read Ayatul Kursi after every obligatory prayer, there is nothing that stands in between you and paradise except death. So it's very worth it. It takes you, what, 15 seconds to read it? If you don't read it, go ahead and start reading it. After every obligatory prayer, read Ayatul Kursi and inshallah, Jannah is your final destination. Surah Al-Ikhlas. Very easy, very simple. Reading it three times is... Reading it once... is so weighty that it equates to the reward of a third of the Qur'an, because it's focusing on the oneness of Allah, and the centre of our religion is oneness of Allah. We believe that Allah is one, he has no partner, he has no son, he has no equal, and those attributes are fundamental to understanding Tawheed, the oneness of Allah. So reading that is very, very weighty. So if you're looking for good deeds, if you're someone who, even if, like, if you are someone who's sinned a lot and you think, oh my God, there's no hope, there is hope for you. But even if you're just someone who wants to bump up, you know, your good deeds, you want to bump up your scales of goodness, just read this Surah Ikhlas three times. It's so easy. You can do it anywhere. You can do it on the go, on the train, on the bus, where you're walking. Just read it, and, you know, don't just read it like a parrot. You know, make sure you read and you understand what you're saying and you really believe in what you're saying and do it really consciously. There's something else for the brothers. I just want to quickly say, I hope I have enough time for this. Five conditions on the day of Jummah. I heard this from a sheikh from Islam Channel. So forgive me if there's errors in what I'm saying. If I watch this video back and I found that I have made mistakes in this, I will comment and update it. But it's not my intention, you know, to misquote what the sheikh said. I just want to share it with you. So this is for brothers. If you fulfill these five conditions on the day of Jummah, Allah will grant you every step of Jummah. Sorry. Let me make this clear, because I have exactly what the sheikh said. Allah will grant you every step, for every step you take towards Jummah prayer, one full year of ibadah, of fasting and praying qiyamul Lail. So that's the night prayer. You're going to get a whole year's worth. So imagine if you take 1,000 steps. It's very easy to do 1,000 steps. For each step, you're going to get a whole year's reward of fasting and praying qiyamul Lail. So this is the five conditions you need to fulfill. So the first one is a proper ghusl, a very good shower. There's another really good video that goes through how to do a perfect ghusl. It's illustrated, animated, it's really, really good. It's a very good video, and I'm going to link that as well in the information bar, so be sure to check that out. Number two, you go to Jummah very early, so around 8 to 9 a.m., you walk and you don't ride to the mosque. So even if you have a car and you're walking, just make sure that you park your car away from the mosque so that you have that benefit, the barakah of walking to the mosque. If you can walk the whole journey, obviously it's better for you. But if you can't, you know, drive halfway or drive near and then come out and walk. Number one, ghusl, proper ghusl. Number two, going there early from 8 to 9. Number three, walking and not riding to the mosque. And number four, coming as close as you can to the imam. So, you know, as close as you can, first row, second row, you know, making sure that you're in there. If you get there early, obviously, you have more of a reward for being able to fulfill that. And number five, he was silent and did not talk during the khutbah. So remember, the reward for every step taken towards the masjid for this Jummah prayer, you will get 1 year of ibadah, fasting and qiyamul Lail. So if you do 1,000, 2,000 steps every Friday, subhanallah, what reward is that? So that's for the brothers, okay? Obviously, Jummah is not obligatory for us sisters. What can we sisters do? There's so much more we can do, and I will promise, inshallah, I will make a video about that. But what we can do, sisters, is to encourage our brothers, our fathers, our husbands, our sons, our uncles, our grandfathers, our friends, whoever we can, to also do this, because inshallah, if you encourage your husband to do this, you're going to get the same reward that he gets in doing this. So make sure, sisters, instill it in your brother, instill it in our brothers, instill your husbands, just to make him get there, go to pray Jummah, fulfilling these five conditions. So I will make sure to write this for you, either in the description bar or in the comments. So I think that's everything I wanted to say, and I hope you have enjoyed this video. I do have more Islamic Muslim lifestyle videos coming up, because Islam is cool and I love Islam. I live for Islam, and you know, alhamdulillah, I am Muslim, and I want to share that with you guys, whether you're Muslim or whether you're not. It's just a way of life that I believe is the best way of life. And it makes me happy to be able to share it with you on this platform. So you will see me, inshallah, in my next video. Thank you for watching, and salam alaikum.